Okay, welcome everyone for the science at 10. This is, I don't know how many science at 10 I've been attending, but it's been quite a while. But this is also a good chance to welcome back Imam, Firni, and Sofyan, who just completed their PhD in the US. And I think this is my last chance to quote unquote supervise. Let's see how he behaves today. But Imam is going to share part of his thesis. He's been working in West Kalimantan for, I don't know, 17 months or so. Yeah, I think it's almost 2 years. And sharing with us what is going on there in terms of land use change in peatland. What is the fate of carbon and carbon dynamic when you change it? And let's see what's going on in West Kalimantan. Imam, time is yours.
Well, thank you very much, Professor Daniel Mudiaso. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for coming to this talk. I hope you are doing great today. Before I begin with the content of my talk, I would like to give briefly the context of my research. As we are all aware about this significant environmental problem that we are facing today, that is climate change. And in this climate change problem, peatland recently come up as a significant player because of its big potential in carbon sequestration, in sequestering carbon from the atmosphere. Well, tropical peatland, especially in Indonesia, is really also facing a threat. One of the main threat to the existence of tropical peatland forest is land use change. As you know, in developing countries like Indonesia and some other countries in tropical areas, economic development is a big factor that in usually a contradictive direction with environmental protection or environmental conservation. In this context, my study is trying to understand, to limit this problem into more understandable question, like understanding the impact of land use, land cover change to carbon dynamic, specifically on carbon stock, carbon emission, and also ecosystem productivity. In this study, I focus in providing the knowledge about the carbon stock emission and ecosystem productivity related to land cover change, especially in tropical peatland forest. Firstly, I would like to examine if the above ground and below ground carbon stock have been decreased with this land use change process. From previous studies, we know that above ground carbon stock have been depleted or significantly reduced by the activity of land clearing, the activity of logging activities, which have reduced the above ground carbon stock from about, let's say, maximum 600 ton carbon per hectare to about 100 or less ton carbon per hectare. The same phenomena we from previous study also showing that below ground carbon stock have been depleted significantly because of this process, mainly from the building of canals, the canalization process to provide suitable, more suitable condition of peat for agricultural crops, as well as from peat fires as an impact of this canalization that maximize the oxidation of peat and make the peat condition drier. Moreover, this deforestation and forest degradation have increased the decomposition rates and also carbon emission significantly. However, we know from previous review of Christo and also Louis Verso that it is very difficult to know the loss of carbon from land use change process. We are facing the difficulty from this unclear pattern of pool density inside the peat profiles, the deep peat profiles that sometimes extend up to 20 meters that we know in Indonesia, as well as the problem to know the reference level that we have to measure the total peat carbon stock beneath the ground. So those are some difficulties that we are facing to know about the total carbon stock of peat swamp forest. Therefore, I try to provide the evidence of the loss on carbon stock and the potential emission from land use change on peat swamp forest by quantifying the carbon stock, the ecosystem carbon stock above ground and below ground in each land use. Available land uses that are happening in the tropical peat swamp forest. And secondly, I studied also the net ecosystem productivity in this ecosystem. I tried to understand the land use change effect on the decrease of ecosystem productivity. That is the knowledge from a previous study from Chimner and Ewa from Micronesian peat swamp forest that peat swamp forest can produce more than 1 ton carbon per hectare annually. So on the other hand, contrasting results still available from the measurement of soil respiration. So to know better about net ecosystem productivity by comparing the primary productivity of peat swamp forest to the soil respiration, we need to better understand to study the difference of net ecosystem productivity among land uses available in the ecosystem. So my strategy to do this is by calculating the net primary productivity, the soil respiration, and at the end, knowing about the net ecosystem productivities in several land use of tropical peat swamp forest landscape. So the field activities I did, as mentioned by Pak Daniel, I did about 17 months field work to measure the different variables that I like to know relevant to the land use change process. My study done in peat dome in Pematang Gadung peat dome in Ketapang, West Kalimantan province in Indonesia. And we selected a research site based on our field observation and also image, satellite image analysis, and also by doing discussion with local experts that can provide us background knowledge about our research site. We consider the availability of peat swamp forest as well as the other land uses that we can compare with, as and also we consider about the relative position between these land uses. So we can assume that all these land uses come from the same initial state, that is peat swamp forest. All sites occur near the center of the peatland, as you can see in this map. This is the overall peat dome, Pematang Gadung peat dome, and my research site covering different land uses all near the center of the peat dome. And then the forest had average canopy height about 15 meters, and The peatland forest has been logged since 1988 from our satellite image analysis, and timber exploitation have been started with the road development, canal development, facilitating the agricultural development in the areas. The other land use that I studied is the log peatland forest surrounding the remnant of intact peatland forest, as well as early serral communities that is dominated by fern and grasses. And the last one is smallholder oil palm plantation that are available and developed from the early serral communities by clearing and also burning the peatland forest by local people. So for carbon stock and emission study, I quantified the ecosystem carbon stock from 19 different sites covering these four land uses, from intact peatland forest as my control, and log peatland forest, oil palm plantation, and then early serral communities. You can see from the upper left hand side the process of degradation of peatland forest here on the background. You can see still some peatland forest left, and they are degraded into log peatland forest. Usually they also develop small drainage system to transport the log out of the forest, and then by peat fires it later on develop early serral communities, and then people start to develop smallholder oil palm plantation. And what we found there was quite surprising, that ecosystem carbon stock significantly different among the land use. We compare between this land use, and we found significant reduction of carbon stock from above ground and below ground stocks. And also, we found that the mean ecosystem carbon stock for intact peatland forest is significantly higher than the other land uses. The difference can reach up to almost 1,000 ton carbon per hectare, and this means that the land use change in tropical peatland forest can significantly increase the carbon emission from the landscape that used to be a carbon sink. In using the estimation based on ecosystem carbon stock difference between these land uses, what we found out that the net loss from a conversion of peatland forest to log peatland forest is reaching about 2,000 ton CO2 per hectare, and to early serral communities it reaches of more than 4,000 ton CO2 per hectare, and to oil palm plantation reaches about 3,000 ton CO2 per hectare. This is a real significant value that we have from our result. And for NEP, for net ecosystem study, I measured the net primary productivity and soil respiration, as well as the groundwater level and soil temperature. So we can understand the impact of land use change on this variable. And what we found from that study, what I found from that study, that the land use change has significantly reduced the primary productivity of this ecosystem, reaching about, for oil palm plantation, for example, smallholder oil palm plantation, can reduce the net primary productivity up to more than 10 ton carbon per hectare annually. And for early cereal, this is quite surprising that the net primary productivity of early cereal communities can compete with the peat swamp forest. While in log over areas, log peat swamp forest, it's slightly decreased, less than 10 ton carbon per hectare. And for soil respiration, I didn't find significant difference between forest and the other land uses. So I can understand that the driver, the main driver of the reduction of net ecosystem productivity from land use change process is from the reduction of the vegetation that can absorb and assimilate carbon from the atmosphere. So in conclusion, our study showed that the tropical coastal peat swamp forest among the largest total ecosystem carbon stock on terrestrial ecosystem, as you can see in this figure, that our peat swamp forest is the largest ecosystem carbon stock. And it's also, land use change has also significantly impacted the peat soil properties, including the bulk density and carbon concentration in the peat profile. After 3 meters depth, we can see that bulk density have increased significantly by the activities of land use change, and the carbon concentration have been significantly increased. And among other ecosystems, net ecosystem productivity of peat swamp forest is quite high, especially compared to the disturbed wetland ecosystem. In this figure, you can see this is the intact peat swamp forest, both in deep peat and in shallow peat, and these are the negative ecosystem productivity of disturbed wetland ecosystem. And from this, we can see from this figure, we can see that peat swamp forest is actually a net sequestering ecosystem that can sequester carbon up to about 11 ton CO2 per hectare per year, while oil palm plantation and logging log over forest is are the net carbon emitter in tropical peat swamp ecosystem. Probably that's all. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you, Imam. Well, I just want to make a note that before we have question and answer, 2 D's that Imam mentioned, the first D is not REDD, but the first D was difficulties. It's a good sign when you're doing research and you ask for difficulties, you have to strive to answer that difficulties. Difficulties in deciding the emission factor. I think that's the main message he was trying to start with when introducing his work. And then the second D is the dynamic. Usually when we do things like this, we provide knowledge or information about stock, full stock, carbon stock. And what Imam gave today is the dynamic. In addition to the stock, what's going to happen? What is the fate of carbon, etc. So we hear about the net primary productivity and then heterotrophic, autotrophic respiration. That's science that we try to provide as a knowledge information. Okay, questions from you colleagues.
Okay, thank you, Imam, for such an interesting result that you share with us. As I remember correctly, when we discussed about your data from when you know we discussed last year, that there was fires happening when you about to do the measurements in your research plots that are affected by fires. So to what extent these fires actually influencing the data that you are collecting before and after the fires, and have, how that would affect the result that you have at the end. Thank you.
Thank you. This is really important question. Thank you for asking this, Bu Ani. I think I have 2 answers for you. The first one is that the fire that happened in September 2014 has reduce my plot sample, in plot numbers. For example, the fire that have burned out my forest plot, I cannot help but to discard it from my analysis. So that I used to have 5 forest plot for my data analysis, then I have to do re-measurement from another sample plot to replace the one that has burned out. And for the other site that have been burned in that same event, I use the I've been continuously doing my measurement for autotrophic and heterotrophic respiration measurement, and then I found out that after fire, the respiration, both autotrophic and heterotrophic respiration, have been much less value than before the fire. That is one of the interesting finding for me, because by this we can see that the fire event actually reduced the heterotrophic and autotrophic respiration. The explanation could be because the more labile carbon has been burned out, and then the microbial communities also have been affected by the fire incident.
It could be the fifth graph, no? The effect of fire. Blessing in disguise. Well, anyway, can be done later. Any other questions?
Thanks for a very interesting presentation. First, I must say that I'm surprised that the net primary production is only 1/3 in the oil palm. I would expect it to be less, but not that much less. Daniel mentioned that this is about the dynamics, and that's really good and important. But then, what about the longer term dynamics? Because if we look at this in a 50-year perspective, just to take a number, and then if we add the risk of fire in each of these 4 times, then I don't want to argue for oil palm plantations here, but just for the sake of academic debate, the risk for fire in the oil palm plantation would probably be lower than the risk for fire in the forested ones. So the dynamics in a longer term perspective, including the risk of fire, would result in different numbers, I think. But I don't know what your thoughts on that is.
Interesting. Imam.
Actually, from my perspective, considering the carbon cycle concept, that respiration, especially through the fire incident, is really will be very high, and we all know the information already that more than 1,000 ton per hectare can be boost from the fire incident. So considering the long-term perspective on the dynamic of carbon in the peatland situation in Indonesia especially, I think managed land has a lower risk of fire incident. So the export of carbon from the terrestrial ecosystem to the atmosphere will be lower, and with additional management activities like planting or letting the grass or ferns grow on the floor of oil palm plantation will also give additional carbon sequestering potential of this oil palm or other managed land, like if we can say agricultural cropland that is managed well, it will also have potential carbon sequestration than the unmanaged land, like the early sera communities. Even in our site, in our research site, the early sera communities is the main problem. The fire occur in this areas almost every year during the dry season.
I think that you really need to have to present a sort of a more comprehensive view of your result, because if you look at the graph of heterotrophic or NAPP, then you can conclude that the best solution is just to wipe out all the forest, store the carbon in terms of paper or wood planks, and then leave it as a shrub, because the shrub is also this Alicera bank. But wouldn't go very well with a lot of people around. Well, in fact, it's because, in fact, what is missing is the fact that these early serum ecosystems are burning every year, so they are emitting. So they're having a sort of an overall picture of, maybe not over the 50 years or 30 years from here, but over 1 year, an average year, something like that. Okay, this is what is happening in this ecosystem. I mean, it's sort of, the primary forest, in fact, is more or less stable. I mean, it represents a huge stock. Very little carbon sequestration, but a little bit, and it's, the early cereal is in fact actively storing carbon because it's a growing vegetation, but because it's burning every year, it's also emitting a lot as very low stock. You know, having a sort of this global view that will very much help the people to understand what is happening.
If I can respond to Robert's comment, I think this is really important point. Because if we see as a whole of the tropical peatland ecosystem, including the change factor like land use change that I've been studied, I think if I, for example, if I'm a manager of these tropical peatland areas, I would keep my leftover peatland forest because considering that it is active. One, it is active in sequestering carbon. As we can see that every year it's still sequestering carbon from the atmosphere. And second, considering the loss of carbon stock from the land use change process that have emitting thousands of tons of carbon to the atmosphere, then I will keep it as tropical peatland forest, because if we change it and if we lose it, we try to restore, we need hundreds of years, probably 100 or 400 years to come back to the initial state of tropical peatland forest. And regarding the unmanaged land like early serral, I agree with Robert because even though it is sequestering carbon based on our study in net ecosystem productivity, but looking at the threat of fire incidents that happening every year in this ecosystem, we need to manage this land. We don't have choice to let it be like that. And we can do rewetting, we can do replanting, but the most important one for me, myself, the first priority will be to keep the leftover peatland forest that we only have 7% today in Indonesia.
If you are the owner, if you are the manager. So I think the issue here is tenure issues. It's always the case that those areas, it's early serral or fallow, it's always problematic everywhere. That's the fire starts usually. One more burning questions, otherwise I will close. And
thanks, Massimo. So I'm just wondering whether, I mean, like, this graph, the right one, NBP and heterotrophic respiration in megagram carbon dioxide in per hectare per year. How about the annual, like monthly variation? You mentioned that you have conducted the research about 17 months, and then is there any relationship between the respiration NBP compared to the rainfall and groundwater level and fire, something like that?
Yeah, I try to see these confounding variables, especially the relation between groundwater level with the heterotrophic respiration or autotrophic respiration, as well as the soil temperature, because from previous study we see contrasting result. People say that there is no relationship among them, and some others found that there are significant relationship. But for based on my data analysis, I think it is too short period that I have the data to see the significant relationship. I didn't see any significant relationship between groundwater level or soil temperature to this respiration. My data only show that significant driver in this net ecosystem productivity is the availability of the vegetation, especially if you see in the forest with these big trees, we have more litter fall production every year, and in early soil ecosystem through the below ground productivity, because there is very quick turnover rate of the grassland roots compared to the other ecosystem. So the variation, I see the variation in groundwater level, I see the variation in heterotrophic respiration, but to see the relationship, I didn't find any significant relation between them.
Okay, so I think time is up, and thank you very much for your feedback, comments, and question and answers. So let's give big applause to Imam. So this is one of the returnees. We will have two more to come. So be prepared that we will have Sofyan and Virni from Florida who is going to share with us in the next science session. Thank you.